This video is part 4 in a series about the Super Nintendo's sound system, the SPC700. In this video, we'll take a short look at the overall DSP pipeline to get a good feel for what it actually has to do to produce sounds and music. We already covered the BRR sample processing in the previous video, which is the starting point of the pipeline, but here we'll look at how those samples are manipulated and combined to produce the final stereo output of the system. And we'll go into detail about the pitch modulation and noise generator features, since they are seldom used features that don't really fit in with any other part of this video series. We'll start at the beginning. First, we need a sound sample that we want to play. So we look into Audio RAM for a BRR formatted sample. To know where exactly to look in ARAM for the sample data, we use the DIR register, which holds the location of the directory table, which is a big list of pointers to all of the currently loaded BRR samples. Then, to know which of these pointers to follow, we check the VXSRCN register, or source number register. Note that the VX here at the start of this register's, and others' names, stands for the voice number. There are 8 voices, so this X could stand for any number 0 through 7. This means there is only one DIR register, but there are 8 source number registers, one for each voice. This way, each voice can use a different sample. This also means that this part of the diagram should really be duplicated 7 more times to be completely accurate, but that would be silly to show. But do know that a portion of this diagram, which I'll highlight in yellow, is just for a single voice, and that there are 8 of them in total. The DSP uses the pointer found in the directory table, along with an internal counter, to keep track of how far along within the BRR sample it is, in order to read 3 bytes from ARAM. These are the header of the current BRR block, and 2 bytes of the sample data within that block. These are fed into a BRR decoder circuit, which amplifies and differentially decodes the sample data if necessary. This is where the 12-word circular buffer is held, that holds the currently processing samples from the BRR block. Then comes the pitch calculation, which uses the 14-bit pitch value from the VXP registers to set the rate at which these samples are interpolated. The result of the 4-point Gaussian interpolation is a 15-bit signed value, which moves on to the next part of the pipeline. Everything I've shown so far was explained more in depth in the previous video in this series, so please check that out if you're interested in the details. There is one thing left out of the previous video, which is the endX register. The X at the end of this register's name, and a few others, denotes that it is an output register, meaning that the DSP writes to it under normal operation, and any software can read its value in order to learn some information about what the DSP is currently doing. In this case, the DSP writes a bit to the endX register if it has reached the end of the currently playing BRR sample. This could be at the end of a sample that doesn't loop, or after a sample has started to loop after reaching the end of the BRR sample for the first time. The endX register consists of 8 bits, 1 bit for each voice. These flags could be used to check if a sample has finished playing without having to know how long the sample was in advance. The 15-bit signed sample value coming from the pitch calculations meets with a switch which is controlled by the noise on register, or NON. NON has 8 bits, one corresponding to each voice, that determine whether this voice should take data from the BRR sample subsystem or the noise generator subsystem. The noise generator subsystem sits outside of the 8 voices, which means there is only one source of random noise. If 2 or more voices have random noise enabled, they will just output the exact same noise signal. The exact frequency of the random noise generator is determined by the lower 5 bits of the FLG flag register. There are only 32 different options here, so it's nothing really special. The noise clock is pulsed at a base rate of 32 kHz, and this value determines how this clock signal is divided. For example, a value of hex 1F divides it by 1, or keeps it at 32 kHz, while a value of hex 1E divides it by 2 for 16 kHz. A value of 1 divides it by 2048 for a frequency of 16 Hz, and a value of 0 essentially disables the clock and outputs a frequency of 0 Hz, which disables the noise generator. This set of 32 divisor numbers will show up later in this series, so keep an eye out for them. The noise generator is a simple 15-bit linear feedback shift register. The initial seed value is negative hex 4000, so all zeros other than a 1 in the very back of the shift register. The taps being the 14th and 15th bits, that is, the current output and the next future output. These bits are exclusively OR'd together and shifted into the back of the register on each clock cycle. The noise generator and the BRR sample subsystems are always both running simultaneously, so a currently playing BRR sample could be swapped out for noise and then back again with just a single key on signal. This is important because if the underlying BRR sample is a non-looping sample and it finishes playing, any noise output will also stop. This is because the next thing in the pipeline, the envelope subsystem, picks up on the end of the BRR sample and puts the voice into release mode, eventually muting the voice. The envelope subsystem applies a volume envelope to the signal being produced by this voice, whether it is noise or a proper sample. This allows the volume of the voice to change over time relative to the start of each note being played, relative to the voice's key on. Different kinds of envelopes can be applied to the same sample in order to produce different sounds, and they can be very powerful and useful for creating expressive music. The next video in this series will be all about the volume envelopes, but allow me to summarize here. A simple gain envelope, or a more complex ADSR envelope, short for attack, decay, sustain, and release, can be configured using the VX gain and VX ADSR registers. The result of this multiplication is another 15-bit signed value. The upper 7 bits of this envelope are exposed via the VX, E, and VX registers, and the upper 8 bits of the result of this multiplication is exposed via the VX, OUT, X registers. There is also a single bit in the flag register called the reset bit that will instantly mute all 8 voices by setting all of their envelope values to 0. The output of this subsystem gets split two ways, one for each stereo channel for the left and right speakers. Each of these gets multiplied by their corresponding channel volumes via the VXVOLL and VXVOLR registers. For these volumes and any other volumes in the pipeline, a negative value will invert the signal, allowing for faux surround sound type effects. One last thing before we get to the mixing and echo phases. The upper 8 bits of the result of the envelope multiplication are available to read by any software via the VXOUTX registers. However, the upper 11 bits of this 15-bit signal are also used for the system's pitch modulation functionality. These 11 bits are fed to the pitch calculator for the next voice in line. So for example, the signal produced by voice 0 can be used to modulate the pitch of voice 1. Instead of the values in the VXP registers being used for pitch directly, they are combined with the incoming signal from the previous voice if pitch modulation is enabled. This is controlled via the PMON register, where each of the 8 bits corresponds to enabling pitch modulation on one voice, apart from voice 0, of course. The exact scaling factor works like this. The incoming modulation signal ranges from negative hex 400 to positive hex 3FF, the upper 11 bits of the 15-bit signal. A signal at the 0 line corresponds to a multiplier of 1, which means no change to the voice's pitch. A signal at the bottom of the range corresponds to a multiplier of 0. This means that there is essentially no range on how low the pitch can drop. Even if the value in the VXP register is its maximum value, an incoming modulation signal at the lowest point will multiply that by 0 and result in a pitch of 0, which would be so low to be inaudible. A signal at the top of the range corresponds to a multiplier of 2. Multiplying the pitch by a factor of 2 would be like raising the pitch by a single octave. There is still an internal limit of hex 3FFF on the resulting pitch value that will be used to interpolate the BRR sample, so if the pitch is already high, you may not get the full range of modulation. Generally, when using pitch modulation, the modulating signal is meant to be muted, since it will probably not sound great as an audio signal itself, but there's nothing preventing the voice from being unmuted. Additionally, a pitch-modulated voice can itself be used as a modulation signal for the next voice in line, if for some reason that was something you would like to do. Since pitch modulation affects two adjacent voices, voice 0 cannot be modulated, since there is no voice before it in line, and voice 7 cannot be used as a modulation signal, since there is no voice after it in line. Alright, time for the first mixing phase. Each of the voices has a 16-bit signed left and right channel at this point, but both of those signals are split into two themselves, resulting in 4 total signals per voice. I'm only going to be showing the left channel in this diagram, but I'll highlight this section in blue so that you know that there is a copy of it for the right channel as well. One branch from each of the channels will be designated the main signal, while the other will be designated the echo signal. The echo signals are all on a switch controlled by the echo on register, or EON. It has 8 bits, one corresponding to each voice, to determine whether that voice will participate in echo or not. While there are 2 switches, one for each the left and right channel, they are either both on or both off. Then, each of these signals from the 8 voices are all mixed together into 16-bit signed signals, the main left and right signals and the echo left and right signals. At this point, the echo signals are just identical to the main signals other than removing those voices that have echo disabled. The 2 main signals are multiplied by the main volume registers MVOLC, the C denoting the channel, left or right, and are sent along their way. It is a misnomer that these registers are often called the master volume registers, but they only control the volume of the main signal and do not affect the volume of the echo signal at all. The echo signals have a bit of a roller coaster ride to go through before they meet back up with the main signals. Again, there will be a future video that goes into echo in all its glorious detail, but for now, let me just summarize and finish up this diagram. With echo, you are saving the sample that has been generated now in a big buffer and will output it at a later time. But in this cycle, you are grabbing a sample from the buffer that was generated a while back and outputting it instead. So the echo signals we have here are not carrying the samples we are interested in at the moment. They should just go into the echo buffer, which is found in ARAM, so we can deal with them later. There is a single bit in the flag register that determines whether these writes to the echo buffer actually go through, and it is off by default. The location of the echo buffer within ARAM is determined by the echo source address, or ESA register. The amount of time in between each echo, which determines how long each pair of stereo samples stays in the buffer, and which determines how large the echo buffer is controlled via the echo delay, or EDL register. An internal counter keeps track of where within the circular buffer we are, which is where the pair of samples we want are located, as well as where the new incoming pair of signals we just generated will be written. These samples are then put through an 8-tap finite impulse response filter. The 8 coefficients are held in the C0 through C7 DSP registers. This can allow for the echoed signal to be put through a low-pass or a high-pass filter, for example. The output of this filter is a 16-bit signed value and is multiplied by the echo volume registers, EVOLC, before being added to the main signals. Additionally, the output of the FIR filter is multiplied with another register, the echo feedback register, or EFB. This result is added to the incoming echo signal before it is written into the echo buffer as a pair of signed 15-bit samples. This allows for echo feedback, or reverb, which means you can hear the audio repeat over and over and over until it eventually decays into nothing, or blasts out your speakers and clips and peaks out, ending in a bunch of static noise. Finally, before the result of the mixed main and echo signals heads to the digital to analog converter, there is one last mute switch controlled by the flag register. This flag is also on by default when you turn the system on, so that the SPC doesn't just begin spitting out static noise due to uninitialized parameters on boot up. When the system is muted, everything is still running in the background, including the BRR samples and echo. It's just that nothing is being output to the speakers. As mentioned, the next two videos in the series will be about the envelope subsystem and the echo subsystem, since they are somewhat complex and deserve videos of their own. Then, to wrap up the series, we'll build a super basic and preliminary sound engine that can play some music tracks and sound effects. Thank you for watching.